aboard. In 35 minutes, we'll steam through teardown and removal of this H23 Pacific-type locomotive from Carson Park in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, and transport by truck to the C&NW Roundhouse in Altoona, Wisconsin. Visit the historic shops and operating turntable at Altoona and witness the complete overhaul and rebuilding of this entire locomotive. So kick back and relax and watch this classy iron horse breathe live steam again for the first time in 36 years. The following video is a condensed version from the original 92-minute program that was released by Pletz Express back in 1999. The official start to the restoration of the 2719 began here at Carson Park on February 25, 1996. The volunteers began the process of removing all excess weight to prepare the engine for the move out of the park. Sitting in the park for 36 years was beginning to take its toll on the old steamer. The tender was separated from the locomotive and eased back 4 feet. This was the first time a wheel turned on the 2719 since 1960. The work continues into the summer. The locomotive was lightened by over 25 tons with the removal of numerous engine parts. On August 2, 1996, volunteers began the process of installing temporary track. This small section of track was laid so the tender could be moved back farther from the engine. A front end loader slowly let the tender roll down the hill to the end of the track. Community spirit takes hold as a local contractor, PV Farmer, donates the use of its 80-ton crane. Shooty Movers, a Wausau, was hired to transport the 2719 across Eau Claire to the Roundhouse in Altoona. The locomotive was framed with huge beams and then elevated off the ground. Sets of trucks were strategically placed under the frame to support the weight. It's now 4:30 in the afternoon, and the movement that everyone was anxiously awaiting for has finally arrived. The 2719 is officially on the move. A winter storm is now moving in as the trucks depart. To minimize street congestion, the locomotive is being moved at night when the city's traffic volumes are at their lowest levels. It's now 7 a.m. December 19th as we see the 2719 coming up Wilson Street in Altoona. The truck is crossing the tracks of the Union Pacific. Throughout the night, the 2719 has had an escort by the Eau Claire Police Department. Plus, Eau Claire County trucks have been leading the way by plowing, salting, and sanding the icy streets. Plus, a front-end loader has also been providing extra traction by shoving in the back. Workers walked alongside the 2719 for a good part of the journey to make sure everything was proceeding safely. The 2719 has reached its destination as the truck pulls into the Altoona Roundhouse. The 2719 is now carefully aligned over a set of tracks that lead to the turntable. The trucks have been removed and the engine has been lowered onto the track. Next, the frame will be removed and the mover's job will be complete. The former Chicago Northwestern Roundhouse is one of the oldest buildings in Altoona and was originally constructed in 1882. After lubricating the wheels, a front-end loader shoves the engine onto the turntable as the drivers turn for the first time since 1960. The 2719 gets a spin on the 90-foot turntable. Next, a Chicago and Northwestern SD18 is coupled onto the old steamer and will give the 2719 a little exercise before going into the roundhouse. This helps to free up the running gear by working lubricants into the bearings and axles. Records seem to indicate that the 2719 was last rebuilt in the 1954 to 1955 time frame. The locomotive was then put into storage and used only a few more times on a series of passenger excursions. After a 40-year absence, the former Chicago and Northwestern Roundhouse is now home once again to a steam locomotive. The workers waste no time as they dive headfirst into this fascinating locomotive. The roundhouse provides the ideal working condition for performing this type of rebuilding. 100-ton air jacks were used to lift up the front end of the engine, as volunteer workers are now removing the front trucks. Every inch of the 2719, both inside and out, will be inspected, cleaned, and repaired as needed to put this classic steamer back in top-notch running condition. Inside the firebox, a worker is keying stay bolts. Restoration is well underway as the roundhouse is abuzz with activity. At the front of the engine, workers are air arcing a damaged liner out of the left cylinder. The 2719 suffered damage to the left cylinder somewhere between 1955 and 1959. Due to the circumstances, the Soo Line only performed a temporary patch job welding repair. The cylinder liner, or sleeves as they are sometimes called, was found cracked and now must be removed and replaced with a new one. There's no shortage of work to be done as we look over the 2719's work order assignment board. Jobs are broken down into three phases, being the boiler, the running gear, and the tender. At this point, there are more parts on the floor than on the locomotive. Here we see side rods, auger screw, and crank pins that are awaiting reconditioning. The front trucks or pilot wheels have been disassembled. All parts have been inspected, cleaned, and primered, and will soon be put back together. To the left is the center pivot yoke for the pilot wheels, and to the right is the Chicago lubricator. A job of this magnitude can never be accomplished without a solid core of volunteers. The 2719 has a group of hard-working, dedicated people who regularly donate their time and talents to accomplish this difficult and often time-consuming task. After inspection, the stoker was found to be in good condition and will be cleaned and reassembled. Old paint is being removed from the drivers and they'll soon be primered. The 2719's tender had its coal bunker reworked. The tank baffles were either welded or replaced. The tank's interior repainted. And new wood decking was installed between the tank and the frame. Plus, the tender's trucks were also dismantled and repaired. All engine appliances, such as water pump, water heater, and compressor, were inspected and found dry with no corrosion, meaning only minimal repair beyond normal overhaul would be needed. This was the only area on the 2719's boiler that rusted so bad that it needed replacing. All other bad spots could be built up with pad welds.
That one's starting to cut over there.
Boring equipment was brought in for the damaged left cylinder. The cylinder is being bored to fit the new liner sleeve. The slow and precise cutting of the cylinder took a day and a half to set up and complete. The boiler patch is now being welded into place. Ultrasounding of the entire boiler had to be performed to measure the thickness of the steel. Any bad areas would either have to be pad welded or replaced. 16 to 18 ultrasound readings were then taken around the entire boiler. The entire boiler shell was then mapped a foot at a time. It took over 3,000 readings to complete, and each one was then documented in writing. New boiler tubes are being cut to the proper length of 21 feet. These 2-inch tubes are used to help heat the boiler water as they conduct burn gases forward to the smoke box. The larger 5-inch flues contain smaller superheater tubes. The hot gases in the flues heat both the water outside the flues plus the steam inside the superheater tubes, raising the steam temperature from 400 degrees to as high as 750 degrees. The 2719's boiler contains 203 2-inch tubes and 32 5-inch flues, which contain the superheater units.
That's it.
A steam locomotive operates by sending heated steam from the boiler into the manifold, which runs horizontally across the top, then down two large steam pipes into the cylinders. As the steam expands into the cylinders, it pushes the pistons, which are connected to rods that turn the driving wheels. The steam is then exhausted out the smokestack. We're now visiting Checker Machine in Minneapolis, Minnesota for a look at their vertical boring machine. The 2719's new cylinder liner has arrived and is now in the process of being machined. The cylinder liner was purchased from the Grand Canyon Railroad, who bought it at an auction from the Norfolk Southern. Purchased for $3,000, the liner was originally cast to fit Norfolk and Western 2662 articulated Mallee number 1218. The liner needs to be machined on both sides and will take almost a week to complete. Back at Altoona, we see workers welding the safe ends and are preparing the superheater flues. The big 5-inch flues are no longer made in the U.S. and had to be ordered from Hamburg, Germany. When they didn't arrive on time, a trade was worked out for another set from a railroad museum in Strasburg, Pennsylvania. The new cylinder liners have arrived and are ready to install. The liner is lowered into an insulated container and will be packed in dry ice to contract the metal. This is done so it will slide into the extremely tight cylinder opening. The liner will sit in dry ice for a few hours and the temperature will drop to well over 100 degrees below zero. While the liner is shrinking in the freezing temperature, the opening is being expanded by heating the cylinder. Now it's a race against time to fit the new liner into the cylinder. Some workers from Northern States Power donated their time and expertise to this procedure since they install similar sleeves into the steam turbines at NSP's hydro plants.
Push it!
A big sigh of relief as the frosty liner has slid into the cylinder and fits perfectly. A worker is threading the boiler for the bushings and caps. A new deck is now being welded onto the tender. The old corroded one had to be torn out to remove the stoker. A brand new engine cab was manufactured from scratch and was modified slightly from the old one, with a knockout in the back section for a third and fourth seat. A piston rod from the 2719 is being mounted for grinding. Seeing the dark and shiny spots shows how much wear has taken place on the 2719's piston rod over the years as it slid back and forth over the bushing. The piston was ground 29 thousandths of an inch to bring it back into round. The dark area is the flat spot, and it's getting smaller and smaller, and eventually will be straight and true. Finishing touches are also going into the engine's cab. The tender is now painted, lettered, and ready for its debut. The little shop crane gives the tender a mighty shove onto the turntable. The 2719 shiny black tender holds 17.5 tons of coal and 12,000 gallons of water. Metal boxes were also added to the top of the 2719's tender for added over-the-road tool and storage capacity. It's now the first week in September, 1997. The 2719's new cab is about to be fit onto the engine. This is probably one of the last and oldest roundhouses in the U.S. that has been in continual use by a railroad since it was built in the 1880s. With its cab now firmly in place, the shop crane now winches the locomotive out of the roundhouse. This will be the first time the locomotive and tender have been joined back together since they were separated at Carson Park. Today's date is November 22, 1997, and this is a very big day in the history of the 2719, as a fire will be lit in the engine's firebox for the first time since 1959. Next door, the Soo Line 1003 is already fired up and ready to roll. Another historic moment has arrived as the 2719 is test fired for the first time in 38 years.
We got some. You want a package of rubber
rabbit? The test firing is a smoking success. The 2719's restoration crew now looks forward to the next goal of getting this fine engine operational and moving under its own power. With its test firing complete, It's now back to the day-to-day task of finishing the restoration. Here we see rock wool insulation being strapped to the boiler shell. After being insulated, the boiler jacket is cut out of 16-gauge sheet metal and bolted down. Scott Lindsay from Steam Operations Incorporated was hired to set up the crosshead guide so the pistons will go straight into the cylinder. This left side was extra time-consuming because of the damaged cylinder. Next, we move on to the insulation of the right side piston. The piston rings are set out and ready to go in. Gary Bensman installs the rings with the help of some volunteers. With the piston in place, the workers are now reinstalling the cylinder head. In another part of the roundhouse, we see the tender and various engine appliances that are being worked on. The power reverse cylinder is in the process of being cleaned and overhauled. A look at the Worthington hot water pump, which was shopped out to be repaired. Working on the pedestal mounted feed water heater. The 2719 takes on a short-lived orange color as the boiler is being primered. The next day, Gary Bensman brings out the spray gun again, this time for the first coat of shiny engine black. After the paint dried, the next step was to reinstall all the cleaned and overhaul engine appliances. The first item to go on was the sand dome, which was mounted on the boiler to help keep the sand dry. A series of pipes sends the sand down to the driver wheels for extra traction when needed. The date on the side rod bushing is December 29, 1954, which would probably coincide with the 2719's last rebuilding. This air pump came from the 1003. The 2719 had two single-stage air compressors, whereas this compound compressor has more brake capacity, plus the operating pressure matches the 2719's boiler at 200 pounds per square inch. The insulation in the cab is now complete and is ready to be covered with sheet metal. Going on the engine next is the air reservoir tank. As the workers bolt on the tank, we get a nice side view comparison of the 2719's huge 75-inch driving wheels. Air piping is now being installed. This series of pipes cools the hot air that comes out of the compressor before it enters into the air tank. The power reverse mechanism is being installed underneath the running board. This gear is for the automatic switch for the reverse movement of the drivers. The Worthington hot water pump is being installed. This system takes water from the hot water heater and pumps it into the boiler. The turbo generator is being reinstalled, and NSP donated the rebuilding of this unit. Sheet metal is being cut out to fit over the insulation and gauges that are mounted in the cab. After the metal is cut out, it is then bolted into place. The Worthington feed water heater, which sits on a pedestal, is being hoisted up and mounted above the water pump. Exhaust steam enters into this unit to preheat water before it goes into the boiler. The big day has finally arrived. It's now 30 months after that first day in Carson Park, and the Soo Line 2719 is anxiously under steam and ready to roll. Today's date is the 27th of July, 1998, and test runs are scheduled to be run up and down the yard track here in Altoona. What a sight! The 2719 is now moving under steam for the first time since those last passenger excursions in June of 1959. The 2719 has a working weight of 497,000 pounds. The steamer has 25 by 26 inch cylinders, impressive 75 inch driving wheels, and an operating boiler pressure of 200 pounds per square inch, which gives the locomotive a starting tractive effort of 36,833 pounds. Let's watch and listen as we witness the Soo 2719 on these historic first break-in runs. The next day, we catch volunteers painting the hot smoke box with a graphite paint. Since heat loss from the smoke box is not important, this area is not insulated like the boiler. So a special heat-resistant graphite paint is used that won't burn off when the metal gets hot. After Monday's test run, all the 2719's nuts and bolts must now be checked and retightened. The night before departure, work is being done on the 2719's braking system. Work goes on late into the night to get both the 2719 and the 1003 ready for tomorrow's departure. The steam era on the Chicago and Northwestern here in Altoona came to an end in 1956. The last steamer to leave the yard was Chicago and Northwestern 282 Mikado number 417 in 1957. The 2719 is the first steamer to depart the roundhouse. The Pacifics were a very popular style passenger locomotive. In a 50-year span, approximately 7,000 were built. In 1923, the Soo Line ordered six H-23-class Pacifics from Elko. They were numbered 2717 to 2723. Seventy-five years later, the 2719 is now entering a second life and doing again what it was originally built for, pulling passenger trains in the classiest of style. The two Soo steamers are now at the Wisconsin Central CF yard. The 2719 is now undergoing a rigorous series of service and safety checks concerning the running gear and other items before continuing on its 99-mile trip to Osceola. The tender is topped off with water before departing. West of Boyceville, Wisconsin, we see a Soo Line doubleheader with a 10:03 in the lead. The six passenger cars belong to the 2719. The 2719 is now in Osceola, where the 462 will be performing a series of break-in runs. With the restoration and early break-in runs a huge success, we see the 2719 as it arrives back at the station in Osceola. Number 36 seems to be a lucky number for the 2719. Built in 1923, it ran on the Soo Line for 36 years before being retired in 1959. The 2719 was then donated to the city of Eau Claire and sat in Carson Park for the next 36 years before its removal and rebuilding in 1996. Now the people of the Upper Midwest have a fantastic opportunity to relive the golden days of steam for hopefully the next 36 years. So come and take a ride on this very special steamer, the Soo Line 2719. We hope you enjoyed the condensed version of the Plutz Express video entitled Soo Line 2719, Restoring a 462 Pacific. To order your copy of the complete 92-minute video that's now available in DVD and Blu-ray, just click on the link below or visit our website at www.plutzexpress.com. Please subscribe to our channel and thank you for watching.